Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Growth, From Microorganisms to Megacities, by Vaclav Smil. Narrated by Eric Jason Martin. Publisher's Note. This audiobook refers to figures included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Preface. Growth is an omnipresent protean reality of our lives, a marker of evolution, of an increase in size and capabilities of our bodies as we reach adulthood, of gains in our collective capacities to exploit the Earth's resources and to organize our societies in order to secure a higher quality of life. Growth has been both an unspoken and an explicit aim of individual and collective striving throughout the evolution of our species and its still short recorded history. Its progress governs the lives of microorganisms as well as of galaxies. Growth determines the extent of oceanic crust and utility of all artifacts designed to improve our lives, as well as the degree of damage any abnormally developing cells can do inside our bodies. And growth shapes the capabilities of our extraordinarily large brains, as well as the fortunes of our economies. Because of its ubiquity, growth can be studied on levels ranging from subcellular and cellular, to reveal its metabolic and regulatory requirements and processes, to tracing long-term trajectories of complex systems, be they geotectonic upheavals, national or global populations, cities, economies, or empires. Terraforming growth, geotectonic forces that create the oceanic and continental crust, volcanoes and mountain ranges, and that shape watersheds, plains, and coasts, proceeds very slowly. Its prime mover, the formation of new oceanic crust at mid-ocean ridges, advances mostly at rates of less than 55 millimeters a year, while exceptionally fast new seafloor creation can reach about 20 centimeters per year. As for the annual increments of continental crust, Raymer and Schubert calculated the addition rate of 1.65 cubic kilometers, and with the total subduction rate, as the old crust is recycled into the mantle, of 0.59 cubic kilometers, that yields a net growth rate of 1.06 cubic kilometers. That is a minuscule annual increment when considering that the continents cover nearly 150 square gigameters and that the continental crust is mostly 35 to 40 kilometers thick, but such growth has continued during the entire Phanerozoic eon, that is for the past 542 million years. And one more, this time vertical, example of inevitably slow tectonic speeds. The uplift of the Himalayas, the planet's most imposing mountain range, amounts to about 10 millimeters per year, figure 0.1. Tectonic growth fundamentally constrains the Earth's climate, as it affects global atmospheric circulation and the distribution of pressure cells, and ecosystemic productivity, as it affects temperature and precipitation, and hence also human habitation and economic activity. But there is nothing we can do about its timing, location, and pace, nor can we harness it directly for our benefit, and hence it will not get more attention in this book. Organismic growth, the quintessential expression of life, encompasses all processes by which elements and compounds are transformed over time into new living mass, biomass. Human evolution has been existentially dependent on this natural growth, first just for foraged and hunted food, later for fuel and raw materials, and eventually for cultivated food and feed plants, and for large-scale exploitation of forest phytomass, as well as for the capture of marine species. This growing human interference in the biosphere has brought a large-scale transformation of many ecosystems, above all, the conversion of forests and wetlands to croplands and extensive use of grassland for grazing animals. Growth is also a sign of progress and an embodiment of hope in human affairs. Growth of technical capabilities has harnessed new energy sources, raised the level and reliability of food supply, and created new materials and new industries. Economic growth has brought tangible material gains with the accumulation of private possessions that enrich our brief lives, and it creates intangible values of accomplishment and satisfaction. But growth also brings anxieties, concerns, and fears. People, be it children marking their increasing height on a door frame, countless chief economists preparing dubious forecasts of output and trade performance, or radiologists looking at magnetic resonance images, worry about it in myriads of different ways. Growth is commonly seen as too slow or as too excessive. It raises concerns about the limits of adaptation and fears about personal consequences and major social dislocations. In response, people strive to manage the growth they can control by altering its pace, to accelerate it, moderate it, or end it, and dream about and strive to extend these controls to additional realms. These attempts often fail even as they succeed, and seemingly permanent mastery may turn out to be only a temporary success. But they never end. We can see them pursued at both extreme ends of the size spectrum as scientists try to create new forms of life by expanding the genetic code and including synthetic DNA in new organisms, as well as proposing to control the Earth's climate through geoengineering interventions. Organismic growth is a product of long evolutionary process, and modern science has come to understand its preconditions, pathways, and outcomes, and to identify its trajectories that conform, more or less closely, to specific functions, overwhelmingly to S-shaped, sigmoid curves. Finding common traits and making useful generalizations regarding natural growth is challenging, but quantifying it is relatively straightforward. So is measuring the growth of many man-made artifacts, tools, machines, productive systems, by tracing their increase in capacity, performance, efficiency, or complexity. In all of these cases, we deal with basic physical units: length, mass, time, electric current, temperature, amount of substance, luminous intensity, and their numerous derivatives, ranging from volume and speed to energy and power. Measuring the growth phenomena involving human judgment, expectations, and peaceful or violent interactions with others is much more challenging. Some complex aggregate processes are impossible to measure without first arbitrarily delimiting the scope of an inquiry and without resorting to more or less questionable concepts. Measuring the growth of economies by relying on such variables as gross domestic product or national income are perfect examples of these difficulties and indeterminacies. But even when many attributes of what might be called social growth are readily measurable, examples range from the average living space per family and possession of household appliances to destructive power of stockpiled missiles and the total area controlled by an imperial power, their true trajectories are still open to diverse interpretations, as these quantifications hide significant qualitative differences. Accumulation of material possessions is a particularly fascinating aspect of growth, as it stems from a combination of a laudable quest to improve quality of life, an understandable but less rational response to position oneself in a broader social milieu, and a rather atavistic impulse to possess, even to hoard. There are those few who remain indifferent to growth and need. India's loincloth'd or entirely naked sadhus and monks belonging to sects that espouse austere simplicity. At the other extreme, we have compulsive collectors, however refined their tastes may be, and mentally sick hoarders who turn their abodes into garbage dumps. But in between, in any population with rising standards of living, we have less dramatic quotidian addictions, as most people want to see more growth, be it in material terms or in intangibles that go under those elusive labels of satisfaction with life or personal happiness achieved through amassing fortunes or having extraordinarily unique experiences. The speeds and scales of these pursuits make it clear how modern is this pervasive experience, and how justified is this growing concern about growth. a doubling of average sizes, has become a common experience during a single lifetime. The mean area of U.S. houses has grown 2.5-fold since 1950. The volume of the United Kingdom's wine glasses has doubled since 1970. Typical mass of European cars had more than doubled since the post-World War II models, Citroën 2CV, Fiat Topolino, weighing less than 600 kilograms to about 1,200 kilograms by 2002. Many artifacts and achievements have seen far larger increases during the same time. The modal area of television screens grew about 15-fold, from the post-World War II standard of 30 centimeters diagonal to the average U.S. size of about 120 centimeters by 2015, with an increasing share of sales taken by TVs with diagonals in excess of 150 centimeters. And even that impressive increase has been dwarfed by the rise of the largest individual fortunes. In 2017, the world had 2,043 billionaires. Relative differences produced by some of these phenomena are not unprecedented, but the combination of absolute disparities arising from modern growth and its frequency and speed is new. Rate of growth. Of course, individuals and societies have been always surrounded by countless manifestations of natural growth, and the quests for material enrichment and territorial aggrandizement were the forces driving societies on levels ranging from tribal to imperial, from raiding neighboring villages in the Amazon to subjugating large parts of Eurasia under a central rule. But during antiquity, the medieval period, and a large part of the early modern era, usually delimited as the 3 centuries between 1500 and 1800, most people everywhere survived as subsistence peasants whose harvest produced a limited and fluctuating surplus sufficient to support only a relatively small number of better-off inhabitants, families of skilled craftsmen and merchants, of mostly small cities, and secular and religious ruling elites. Annual crop harvests in those simpler pre-modern and early modern societies presented few, if any, signs of notable growth. Similarly, nearly all fundamental variables of pre-modern life, be they population totals, town sizes, longevities and literacy, animal herds, household possessions, and capacities of commonly used machines, grew at such slow rates that their progress was evident only in very long-term perspectives. And often, they were either completely stagnant or fluctuated erratically around dismal means, experiencing long spells of frequent regressions. For many of these phenomena, we have the evidence of preserved artifacts and surviving descriptions, and some developments we can reconstruct from fragmentary records spanning centuries. For example, in ancient Egypt, it took more than 2,500 years, from the age of the Great Pyramids to the post-Roman era, to double the number of people that could be fed from 1 hectare of agricultural land. Stagnant yields were the obvious reason, and this reality persisted until the end of the Middle Ages. Starting in the 14th century, it took more than 400 years for average English wheat yields to double, with hardly any gains during the first 200 years of that period. Similarly, many technical gains unfolded very slowly. Water wheels were the most powerful inanimate prime movers of pre-industrial civilizations, but it took about 17 centuries, from the 2nd century of the Common Era to the late 18th century, to raise their typical power tenfold, from 2 kilowatts to 20 kilowatts. Stagnating harvests, or at best, a feeble growth of crop yields and slowly improving manufacturing and transportation capabilities, restricted the growth of cities. Starting in 1300, it took more than 3 centuries for the population of Paris to double to 400,000, but during the late 19th century, the city doubled in just 30 years, 1856 to 1886, to 2.3 million. And many realities remained the same for millennia. The maximum distance covered daily by horse-riding messengers, the fastest way of long-distance communication on land before the introduction of railways, was optimized already in ancient Persia by Cyrus when he linked Susa and Sardis after 550 BCE, and it remained largely unchanged for the next 2,400 years. The average speed of relays, 13 to 16 kilometers per hour, and a single animal ridden no more than 18 to 25 kilometers per day, remained near constant. Many other entries belong to this stagnant category, from the possession of household items by poor families to literacy rates prevailing among rural populations. Again, both of these variables began to change substantially only during the latter part of the early modern era. Once so many technical and social changes, growth of railway networks, expansion of steamship travel, rising production of steel, invention and deployment of internal combustion engines and electricity, rapid urbanization, improved sanitation, rising life expectancy, began to take place at unprecedented rates during the 19th century, their rise created enormous expectations of further continued growth. And these hopes were not disappointed, as, despite setbacks brought by the two world wars, other conflicts, and periodic economic downturns, capabilities of individual machines, complicated industrial processes, and entire economies continued to grow during the 20th century. This growth was translated into better physical outcomes, increased body heights, higher life expectancies, greater material security and comfort, be it measured by disposable incomes or ownership of labor-easing devices, and unprecedented degrees of communication and mobility. Nothing has embodied this reality and hope during recent decades as prominently as the growth in the number of transistors and other components that we have been able to emplace on a silicon wafer. Widely known as conforming to Moore's Law, this growth has seen the number of components roughly double every 2 years. As a result, the most powerful microchips made in 2018 had more than 23 billion components, seven orders of magnitude, about 10.2 million times, to be more exact, greater than the first such device, Intel's 4004, a 4-bit processing unit with 2,300 components for a Japanese calculator, designed in 1971. As in all cases of exponential growth, when these gains are plotted on a linear graph, they produce a steeply ascending curve, while a plot on a semi-logarithmic graph transforms them into a straight line, figure 0.2. This progress has led to almost unbounded expectations of still greater advances to come, and the recent rapid diffusion of assorted electronic devices and applications they use has particularly mesmerized those uncritical commentators who see omnipresent signs of accelerated growth. To give just one memorable recent example, a report prepared by Oxford Martin School and published by Citi claims the following time spans were needed to reach 50 million users. Telephone, 75 years. Radio, 38 years. TV, 13 years. Internet, 4 years. And Angry Birds, 35 days. These claims are attributed to Citi Digital Strategy Team, but the team failed to do its homework and ignored common sense. Are these numbers referring to global or American diffusions? The report does not say, but the total of 50 million clearly refers to the United States, where that number of telephones was reached in 1953, 1878 plus 75 years. But the number of telephones does not equal the total number of their users, which, given the average size of families and the ubiquity of phones in places of work, had to be considerably higher. TV broadcasting did not have just one, but a number of beginnings. American transmission and sales of first sets began in 1928, but 13 years later, in 1941, TV ownership was still minimal, and the total number of TV sets, again devices, not users, reached 50 million only in 1963. The same error is repeated with the Internet, to which millions of users had access for many years at universities, schools, and workplaces before they got a home connection. Besides, what was the Internet's first year? All that is just sloppy data gathering and an uninformed rush to make an impression, but more important is an indefensible categorical error made by comparing a complex system based on a new and extensive infrastructure with an entertaining software. Telephony of the late 19th century was a pioneering system of direct personal communication whose realization required the first large-scale electrification of society, from fuel extraction to thermal generation to transmission, with large parts of rural America having no good connections even during the 1920s, installation of extensive wired infrastructure, and sales of, initially separate, receivers and speakers. In contrast, Angry Birds or any other inane app can spread in a viral fashion because we have spent more than a century putting in place the successive components of a physical system that has made such a diffusion possible. Its growth began during the 1880s with electricity generation and transmission, and it has culminated with the post-2000 wave of designing and manufacturing billions of mobile phones and installing dense networks of cell towers. Concurrently, the increasing reliability of its operation makes rapid diffusion feats unremarkable. Any number of analogies can be offered to illustrate that comparative fallacy. For example, instead of telephones, think of the diffusion of microwave ovens, and instead of an app, think of mass-produced microwavable popcorn. Obviously, diffusion rates of the most popular brand of the latter will be faster than were the adoption rates of the former. In fact, in the U.S., it took about 3 decades for countertop microwave ovens, introduced in 1967, to reach 90% of all households. The growth of information has proved equally mesmerizing. There is nothing new about its ascent. The invention of movable type in 1450 began an exponential rise in book publishing from about 200,000 volumes during the 16th century to about 1 million volumes during the 18th century, while recent global annual rate, led by China, the U.S., and the United Kingdom, has surpassed 2 million titles. Add to this pictorial information, whose growth was affordably enabled first by lithography, then by rotogravure, and now is dominated by electronic displays on mobile devices. Sound recordings began with Edison's fragile phonograph in 1878, figure 0.3, and their enormous selection is now effortlessly accessible to billions of mobile phone users. And information flow in all of these categories is surpassed by imagery incessantly gathered by entire fleets of spy, meteorological, and Earth observation satellites. Not surprisingly, aggregate growth of information has resembled the hyperbolic expansion trajectory of pre-1960 global population growth. Recently, it has been possible to claim that 90% or more of all the extant information in the world has been generated over the preceding 2 years. Seagate put total information created worldwide at 0.1 zettabytes in 2005, at 2 zettabytes in 2010, 16.1 zettabytes in 2016, and it expected that the annual increment will reach 163 zettabytes by 2025. A year later, it raised its estimate of the global datasphere to 175 zettabytes by 2025, and expected that the total will keep on accelerating. But as soon as one considers the major components of this new data flood, those accelerating claims are hardly impressive. Highly centralized new data inflows include the incessant movement of electronic cash and investments among major banks and investment houses, as well as sweeping monitoring of telephone and internet communications by government agencies. At the same time, billions of mobile phone users participating in social media voluntarily surrender their privacy so data miners can, without asking anybody a single question, follow their messages and their web clicking, analyzing the individual personal preferences and foibles they reveal, comparing them to those of their peers, and packaging them to be bought by advertisers in order to sell more unneeded junk and to keep economic growth intact. And of course, streams of data are produced incessantly simply by people carrying GPS-enabled mobile phones. Add to this the flood of inane images, including myriads of selfies and cat videos. Even stills consume bytes rapidly. Smartphone photos take up commonly 2 to 3 megabytes. This is 2 to 3 times more than the typescript of this book. And the unprecedented growth of information appears more pitiable than admirable. And this is one of the most consequential, undesirable consequences of this information flood. Time spent per adult user per day with digital media doubled between 2008 and 2015 to 5.5 hours, creating new life forms of screen zombies. But the rapid diffusion of electronics and software are trivial matters compared to the expected ultimate achievements of accelerated growth, and nobody has expressed them more expansively than Ray Kurzweil since 2012, the director of engineering at Google, and long before that, the inventor of such electronic devices as the charged couple flatbed scanner, the first commercial text-to-speech synthesizer, and the first omnifont optical character recognition. In 2001, he formulated his law of accelerating returns. An analysis of the history of technology shows that technological change is exponential, contrary to the common sense, intuitive, linear view. So we won't experience 100 years of progress in the 21st century. It will be more like 20,000 years of progress at today's rate. The returns, such as chip speed and cost effectiveness, also increase exponentially. There's even exponential growth in the rate of exponential growth. Within a few decades, machine intelligence will surpass human intelligence, leading to the singularity, technological change so rapid and profound it represents a rupture in the fabric of human history. The implications include the merger of biological and non-biological intelligence, immortal software-based humans, and ultra-high levels of intelligence that expand outward in the universe at the speed of light. In 2005, Kurzweil published The Singularity is Near. It is to come in 2045, to be exact. And ever since, he has been promoting these views on his website, Kurzweil Accelerating Intelligence. There is no doubt, no hesitation, no humility in Kurzweil's categorical grand pronouncements, because according to him, the state of the biosphere, whose functioning is a product of billions of years of evolution, has no role in our futures, which are to be completely molded by the surpassing mastery of machine intelligence. But as different as our civilization may be when compared to any of its predecessors, it works within the same constraint. It is nothing but a subset of the biosphere, that relatively very thin and both highly resilient and highly fragile envelope within which carbon-based living organisms can survive. Inevitably, their growth, and for higher organisms also their cognitive and behavioral advances, are fundamentally limited by the biosphere's physical conditions and, wide as it may seem by comparing its extremes, by the restricted range of metabolic possibilities. Studies of growth. Even when limited to our planet, the scope of growth studies, from ephemeral cells to a civilization supposedly racing toward the singularity, is too vast to allow a truly comprehensive single-volume treatment. Not surprisingly, the published syntheses and overviews of growth processes and of their outcomes have been restricted to major disciplines or topics. The great classic of growth literature, Darcy Wentworth Thompson's On Growth and Form, whose original edition came out in 1917 and whose revised and much expanded form appeared in 1942, is concerned almost solely with cells and tissues and with many parts, skeletons, shell, horns, teeth, tusks, of animal bodies. The only time when Thompson wrote about non-biogenic materials or man-made structures, metals, girders, bridges, was when he reviewed the forms and mechanical properties of such strong biogenic tissues as shells and bones. The Chemical Basis of Growth and Senescence by T.B. Robertson, published in 1923, delimits its scope in the book's title. In 1945, another comprehensive review of organismic growth appeared, Samuel Brody's Bioenergetics and Growth, whose content was specifically focused on the efficiency complex in domestic animals. In 1994, Robert Banks published a detailed inquiry into growth and diffusion phenomena, and although this excellent volume provides numerous examples of specific applications of individual growth trajectories and distribution patterns in natural and social sciences and in engineering, its principal concern is captured in its subtitle, as it deals primarily, and in an exemplarily systematic fashion, with mathematical frameworks and applications. The subtitle of an edited homage to Thompson, with the eponymous title On Growth and Form, announced the limits of its inquiry, Spatio-Temporal Pattern Formation in Biology. As diverse as its chapters are, including pattern formations on butterfly wings, in cancer, and in skin and hair, as well as growth models of capillary networks and wound healing, the book was, once again, about growth of living forms. And in 2017, Jeffrey West summed up decades of his inquiries into universal laws of scaling, not only of organisms, but also cities, economies, and companies, in a book titled Scale that listed all of these subjects in its long subtitle, and whose goal was to discern common patterns and even to offer the vision of a grand unified theory of sustainability. Components of organic growth, be they functional or taxonomic, have received much attention, and comprehensive treatments deal with cellular growth, growth of plants, and animals. As expected, there is an enormous body of knowledge on human growth in general. Healthy growth and nutrition in children have received particular attention, with perspectives ranging from anthropometry to nutrition science, and from pediatrics and physiology to public health. Malthus and Verhulst published pioneering inquiries into the nature of population growth, whose modern evaluations range from Pearl and Reed and Carr Saunders to Meadows et al., Kiefitz and Flieger, Hardin, Cohen, Stanton, Lutz et al., and numerous reviews and projections published by the United Nations. Modern economics has been preoccupied with the rates of output, profit, investment, and consumption growth. Consequently, there is no shortage of inquiries pairing economic growth and income, growth and technical innovation, growth and international trade, and growth and health. Many recent studies have focused on links between growth and corruption and growth and governance. Publications are also dispensing advice on how to make all economic growth sustainable and equitable. As already noted, the long life of Moore's Law has focused interest on the growth of computational capabilities, but inexplicably, there are no comprehensive book-length studies on the growth of modern technical and engineering systems, such as long-term analyses of capacity and performance growth in extractive activities and energy conversions. And even when including papers, there is only a limited number of publications dealing explicitly with the growth of states, empires, and civilizations. What is and is not in this book? The impossibility of a truly comprehensive account of growth in nature and society should not be an excuse for the paucity of broader inquiries into the modalities of growth. My intent is to address this omission by examining growth in its many natural, social, and technical forms. In order to cover such a wide sweep, a single volume must be restricted in both its scope and depth of coverage. The focus is on life on Earth and on the accomplishments of human societies. This assignment will take us from bacterial invasions and viral infections through forest and animal metabolism to the growth of energy conversions and megacities to the essentials of the global economy, while excluding both the largest and the smallest scales. There will be nothing about the growth, the inflationary expansion of the universe, galaxies, supernovas, or stars. I have already acknowledged inherently slow growth rates of terraforming processes that are primarily governed by the creation of new oceanic crust, with spreading rates ranging between less than 2 and no more than about 20 centimeters per year. And while some short-lived and spatially limited catastrophic events, volcanic eruptions, massive landslides, tsunami waves, enormous floods, can result in rapid and substantial mass and energy transfers in short periods of time, ongoing geomorphic activities, erosion and its counterpart, sedimentary deposition, are as slow or considerably slower than the geotectonic processes. Erosion in the Himalayas can advance by as much as 1 centimeter per year, but the denudation of the British Isles proceeds at just 2 to 10 centimeters in every 1,000 years. There will be no further examination of these terraforming growth rates in this book. And as the book's major focus is on the growth of organisms, artifacts, and complex systems, there will be also nothing about growth on subcellular level. The enormous intensification of life science research has produced major advances in our understanding of cellular growth in general and cancerous growth in particular. The multidisciplinary nature, the growing extent, and accelerating pace of these advances means that new findings are now reported overwhelmingly in electronic publications, and that writing summary or review books in these fields are exercises in near-instant obsolescence. Still, among the recent books, those by Masiera Quello, Gewurz et al., Kimura, and Krykiewski offer surveys of normal and abnormal cellular growth and death. Consequently, there will be no systematic treatment of fundamental genetics, epigenetics, and biochemistry of growth, and I will deal with cellular growth only when describing the growth trajectories of unicellular organisms and the lives of microbial assemblies whose presence constitutes significant or even dominant shares of biomass in some ecosystems. Similarly, the focus with plants, animals, and humans will not be on biochemical specificities and complexities of growth at subcellular, cellular, and organ level. There are fascinating studies of brain or heart development, but on entire organisms, including the environmental settings and outcomes of growth, and I will also note some key environmental factors, ranging from micronutrients to infections, that often limit or derail organismic growth. Human physical growth will be covered in some detail, with focus both on individual and sex-specific growth trajectories of height and weight, as well as on the undesirable rise of obesity, and on the collective growth of populations. I will present long-term historical perspectives of population growth, evaluate current growth patterns, and examine possible future global and some national trajectories. But there will be nothing on psychosocial growth, developmental stages, personality, aspirations, self-actualization, or on the growth of consciousness. Psychological and sociological literature covers that abundantly. Before proceeding with systematic coverage of growth in nature and society, I will provide a brief introduction into the measures and varieties of growth trajectories. These trajectories include erratic advances with no easily discernible patterns, often seen in stock market valuations, Simple linear gains. An hourglass adds the same amount of falling sand to the bottom pile every second. Growth that is temporarily exponential, commonly exhibited by such diverse phenomena as organisms in their infancy, the most intensive phases in the adoption of technical innovation, and the creation of stock market bubbles, and gains that conform to assorted, confined, restrained growth curves, as do body sizes of all organisms whose shape can be captured by mathematical functions. Most growth processes, be they of organisms, artifacts, or complex systems, follow closely one of these S-shaped, sigmoid, growth curves conforming to the logistic, Verhulst, function, to its precursor, Gompertz, or to one of their derivatives, most commonly those formulated by von Bertalanffy, Richards, Bloomberg, and Turner et al. But natural variability, as well as unexpected interferences, often lead to substantial deviations from a predicted course. That is why the students of growth are best advised to start with an actual, more or less completed progression, and see which available growth function comes closest to replicating it. Proceeding the other way, taking a few early points of an unfolding growth trajectory and using them to construct an orderly growth curve conforming to a specifically selected growth function, has a high probability of success only when one tries to predict the growth that is very likely to follow a known pattern that has been repeatedly demonstrated, for example, by many species of coniferous trees or freshwater fish. But selecting a random S-curve as the predictor of growth for an organism that does not belong to one of those well-studied groups is a questionable enterprise, because a specific function may not be a very sensitive predictive tool for phenomena seen only in their earliest stage of growth. The book's structure and goals. The text follows a natural evolutionary sequence, from nature to society, from simple, directly observable growth attributes, numbers of multiplying cells, diameter of trees, mass of animal bodies, progression of human statures, to more complex measures marking the development and advances of societies and economies, population dynamics, destructive powers, creation of wealth. But the sequence cannot be exclusively linear, as there are ubiquitous linkages, interdependencies, and feedbacks, and these realities necessitate some returns and detours, some repetitions to emphasize connections seen from other energetic, demographic, economic perspectives. My systematic inquiry into growth will start with organisms whose mature sizes range from microbes, tiny as individual cells, massive in their biospheric presence, to lofty coniferous trees and enormous whales. I will take closer looks at the growth of some disease-causing microbes, at the cultivation of staple crops, and at human growth from infancy to adulthood. Then will come inquiries into the growth of energy conversions and man-made objects that enable food production and all other economic activities. I will also look how this growth changed numerous performances, efficiencies, and reliabilities, because these developments have been essential for creating our civilization. Finally, I will focus on the growth of complex systems. I will start with the growth of human populations and proceed to the growth of cities, the most obvious concentrated expressions of human material and social advancement, and economies. I will end these systematic examinations by noting the challenges of appraising growth trajectories of empires and civilizations, ending with our global variety characterized by its peculiar amalgam of planetary and parochial concerns, affluent and impoverished lives, and confident and uncertain perspectives. The book will close with reviewing what comes after growth. When dealing with organisms, the outcomes range from the death of individuals to the perpetuation of species across evolutionary time spans. When dealing with societies and economies, the outcomes range from decline, gradual to rapid, and demise, to sometimes remarkable renewal. The trajectory of the modern civilization, coping with contradictory imperatives of material growth and biospheric limits, remains uncertain. My aim is to illuminate varieties of growth in evolutionary and historical perspectives, and hence to appreciate both the accomplishments and the limits of growth in modern civilization. This requires quantitative treatment throughout, because real understanding can be gained only by charting actual growth trajectories, appreciating common and exceptional growth rates, and setting accomplished gains and performance improvements, often so large that they have spanned several orders of magnitude, into proper historical and comparative contexts. Biologists have studied the growth of numerous organisms, and I review scores of such results for species ranging from bacteria to birds and from algae to staple crops. Similarly, details of human growth from infancy to maturity are readily available. In contrast to the studies of organismic growth, quantifications of long-term growth trajectories of human artifacts, ranging from simple tools to complex machines and complex systems, ranging from cities to civilizations, are much less systematic and much less common. Merely to review published growth patterns would not suffice to provide revealing treatments of these growth categories. That is why, in order to uncover the best fitting patterns of many kinds of anthropogenic growth, I have assembled the longest possible records from the best available sources and subjected them to quantitative analyses. Every one of more than 100 original growth graphs was prepared in this way, and their range makes up, I believe, a unique collection. Given the commonalities of growth patterns, this is an unavoidably repetitive process, but systematic presentations of specific results are indispensable in order to provide a clear understanding of realities, commonalities and exceptions, limits, and future possibilities. Systematic presentation of growth trajectories is a necessary precondition, but not the final goal when examining growth. That is why I also explain the circumstances and limits of the charted growth, provide evolutionary or historical settings of analyzed phenomena, or offer critical comments on recent progression and on their prospects. I also caution about any simplistic embrace of even the best statistical fits for long-term forecasting, and the goal of this book is not to provide an extended platform for time-specific growth projections. Nevertheless, the presented analyses contain a variety of conclusions that make for realistic appraisals of what lies ahead. In that sense, parts of the book are helpfully predictive. If a century of corn yields shows only linear growth, there is not much of a chance for exponentially rising harvests in the coming decades. If the growth efficiency of broilers has been surpassing, for generations, the performance of all other terrestrial meat animals, then it is hard to argue that pork should be the best choice to provide more protein for billions of new consumers. If unit capacities, production, extraction or generation rates, and diffusion of every energy conversion display logistic progress, then we have very solid ground to conclude that the coming transition from fossil fuels to renewables will not be an exceptionally speedy affair. If the world's population is getting inexorably urbanized, its energetic, food, fuels, electricity, and material needs will be shaped by these restrictive realities, dictating the need for incessant and reliable mass-scale flows that are impossible to satisfy from local or nearby sources. Simply put, this book deals in realities as it sets the growth of everything into long-term evolutionary and historical perspectives, and does so in rigorous quantitative terms. Documented, historically embedded facts come first, cautious conclusions afterward. This is, of course, in contradistinction to many recent ahistoric forecasts and claims that ignore long-term trajectories of growth, that is, the requisite energetic and material needs of unprecedented scaling processes, and invoke the fashionable mantra of disruptive innovation that will change the world at accelerating speed. Such examples abound, ranging from all of the world's entire car fleet of more than 1 billion vehicles becoming electric by 2025 to terraforming Mars starting in the year 2022, from designer plants and animals, synthetic biology rules, making the strictures of organismic evolution irrelevant, to anticipations of artificial intelligence's imminent takeover of our civilization. This book makes no radical claims of that kind. In fact, it avoids making any but strongly justified generalizations. This is a deliberate decision resting on my respect for complex and unruly realities and irregularities, and on the well-attested fact that grand predictions turn out to be, repeatedly, wrong. Infamous examples concerning growth range from those of unchecked expansion of the global population and unprecedented famines that were to happen during the closing decades of the 20th century, to a swift takeover of the global energy supply by inexpensive nuclear power, and to a fundamentally mistaken belief that the growth rate underlying Moore's law, doubling every 2 years, can be readily realized through innovation in other fields of human endeavor. The book is intended to work on several planes. The key intent is to provide a fairly comprehensive analytical survey of growth trajectories in nature and in society. In the biosphere, where growth is the result of not just evolution, but increasingly of human intervention, and in the man-made world, where growth has been a key factor in the history of populations and economies and in the advancement of technical capabilities. Given this scope, the book could also be heard selectively as a combination of specific parts. By focusing on living organisms, be they plants, animals, humans, or populations, or on human designs, be they tools, energy converters, or transportation machinery. And undoubtedly, some listeners will be more interested in the settings of growth processes, in preconditions, factors, and the evolutionary and historical circumstances of natural, population, economic, and imperial growth, rather than in specific growth trajectories. Yet another option is to focus on the opposite scales of growth. The book contains plenty of information about the growth of individual organisms, tools, machines, or infrastructures, as well as about the growth of the most extensive and the most complex systems, culminating in musings about the growth of civilizations. The book is also a summation of unifying lessons learned about the growth of organisms, artifacts, and complex systems, and it can be also understood as an appraisal of evolutionary outcomes in nature and as a history of technical and social advances, that is, as an assessment of civilizational progress. Record might be a better neutral designation than progress. As always in my writings, I stay away from any rigid prescriptions, but I hope that the book's careful reading conveys the key conclusion. Before it is too late, we should embark in earnest on the most fundamental, existential, and also truly revolutionary task facing modern civilization, that of making any future growth compatible with the long-term preservation of the only biosphere we have. Chapter 1. Trajectories, or Common Patterns of Growth. Growth attracts adjectives. The most common ones have been, alphabetically, anemic, arithmetic, cancerous, chaotic, delayed, disappointing, erratic, explosive, exponential, fast, geometric, healthy, interrupted, linear, logistic, low, malignant, moderate, poor, rapid, runaway, slow, S-shaped, strong, sudden, tepid, unexpected, vigorous. Most recently, we should also add sustainable and unsustainable. Sustainable growth is, of course, a clear contradictio in adjecto as far as any truly long-run material growth is concerned. I am ignoring any possibilities of migrating to other planets after exhausting the Earth's resources. And it is highly doubtful that we can keep on improving such intangibles as happiness or satisfaction. Most of the adjectives used to describe growth are qualifiers of its rate. Often it is not the growth per se that we worry about, but rather its rate, either too fast or too slow. Even a casual newsreader knows about the constant worries of assorted chief economists, forecasters, and government officials about securing vigorous or healthy growth of the gross domestic product, GDP. This clamoring for high growth rates is based on the most simplistic expectation of repeating past experiences, as if the intervening growth of GDP had nothing to do with the expected future rate. Put another way, economists have an implicit expectation of endless, and preferably fairly fast, exponential growth. But they choose an inappropriate metric when comparing the outcomes. For example, during the first half of the 1950s, the U.S. GDP growth averaged nearly 5% a year, and that performance translated roughly to additional $3,500 per capita for about 160 million people during those 5 years. In contrast, the slow GDP growth between 2011 and 2015, averaging just 2% a year, added about $4,800 per capita for about 317 million people during those 5 years, or nearly 40% more than 60 years ago. All totals are in constant value monies to eliminate the effect of inflation. Consequently, in terms of actual average individual betterment, the recent 2% growth has been quite superior to the former 2.5 times higher rate. This is simple algebra, but it is repeatedly ignored by all those bewailing the low post-2000 growth of the U.S. or European Union EU economies. Results of the British referendum of June 23, 2016, about remaining in the EU or leaving it, provided another perfect illustration of how the rate of change matters more than the outcome. In 94% of the areas where the foreign-born population increased by more than 200% between 2001 and 2014, people voted to leave the European Union, even though the share of migrants in those regions had remained comparatively low, mostly less than 20%. In contrast, most regions where the foreign-born population was more than 30% voted to remain. As The Economist concluded, high numbers of migrants don't bother Britons, high rates of change do. Other adjectives used to qualify growth are precisely defined terms describing its specific trajectories that conform, sometimes almost perfectly, often fairly closely, to various mathematical functions. Those close, even perfect fits are possible because most growth processes are remarkably regular affairs as their progress follows a limited array of patterns. Naturally, those trajectories have many individual and inter- and intra-specific variations for organisms and are marked by historically, technically, and economically conditioned departures for engineered systems, economies, and societies. The three basic trajectories encompass linear growth, exponential growth, and various finite growth patterns. Linear growth is trivial to grasp and easy to calculate. Exponential growth is easy to understand, but the best way to calculate it is to use the base of natural logarithms, a mystery to many. The principle of finite growth patterns, including logistic, Gompertz, and confined exponential growth functions, is again easy to understand, but their mathematical solutions require differential calculus. But before taking a closer look at individual growth functions, their solutions, and resulting growth curves, I will devote two brief sections to time spans and to the figures of merit involved in growth studies. In their short surveys, I will note both common and less frequently encountered variables in whose growth we are interested, be it as parents, employees, or taxpayers, as scientists, engineers, and economists, or as historians, politicians, and planners. These measures include such universal concerns as the weight and height of growing babies and children, and the growth of national economies. And there are also such infrequent but scary concerns as the diffusion of potentially pandemic infections made worse by mass-scale air travel. Time spans. Growth is always a function of time, and during the course of modern scientific and engineering studies, their authors have traced its trajectories in countless graphs, with time usually plotted on the abscissa, horizontal or x-axis, and the growing variable measured on the ordinate, vertical or y-axis. Of course, we can, and we do, trace growth of physical or immaterial phenomena against the change of other such variables. We plot the changing height of growing children against their weight or rising disposable income against the growth of GDP, but most of the growth curves, and in simpler instance, lines, are what James C. Maxwell defined as diagrams of displacement and what Thomson called time diagrams. Each has a beginning and an end, and one and the same curve may illustrate the life of a man, the economic history of a kingdom. It depicts a mechanism at work and helps us to see analogous mechanisms in different fields, for nature rings her many changes on a few simple themes. Growth of ocean floor or of mountain ranges, whose outcomes are driven by geotectonic forces and whose examination is outside of this book's already large scope, unfolds across tens to hundreds of millions of years. When dealing with organisms, the length of time span under consideration is a function of specific growth rates determined by long periods of evolution and, in the case of domesticated plant and animal species, often accelerated or enhanced by traditional breeding and, most recently, also by transgenic interventions. When dealing with the growth of devices, machines, structures, or any other human artifacts, time spans under study depend both on their longevity and on their suitability to be deployed in new, enhanced versions under changed circumstances. As a result, growth of some artifacts that were in use since the antiquity is now merely of historical interest. Sails are a good example of this reality, as their development and deployment, excepting those designed and used for fast yacht racing, ended fairly abruptly during the second half of the 19th century, just a few decades after the introduction of steam engines and after more than 5 millennia of improving designs. But other ancient designs have seen spectacular advances in order to meet the requirements of the industrial age. Construction cranes and dockyard cranes are perhaps the best example of this continued evolution. These ancient machines have seen enormous growth in their capacities during the past 2 centuries in order to build taller structures and to handle cargo of increasingly more voluminous ships. Microbes, fungi, and insects make up most of the biosphere's organisms, and common time spans of interest in microbiology and invertebrate biology are minutes, days, and weeks. Bacterial generations are often shorter than 1 hour. Coccolithophores, single-celled, calcifying marine algae that dominate oceanic phytomass, reach maximum cell density in nitrogen-limited environments in 1 week. Commercially cultivated white mushrooms grow to maturity just 15 to 25 days after the growing medium, straw or other organic matter, is filled with mycelium. Butterflies usually spend no more than a week as eggs, 2 to 5 weeks as caterpillars, larval stage, and 1 to 2 weeks as chrysalis, from which they emerge as fully grown adults. In annual plants, days, weeks, and months are time spans of interest. The fastest growing crops, green onions, lettuces, radishes, may be harvested less than a month after seeding. The shortest period to produce mature staple grain is about 90 days, spring wheat, also barley and oats, but winter wheat needs more than 200 days to reach maturity, and a new vineyard will start producing only during the third year after its establishment. In trees, the annual deposition of new wood in rings, secondary growth originating in two cambial lateral meristems, marks an easily identifiable natural progression. Fast-growing plantation species, eucalypts, poplars, pines, may be harvested after a decade of growth, or even sooner, but in natural settings, growth can continue for many decades, and in most tree species, it can be actually indeterminate. Gestation growth of larger vertebrates lasts for many months, from 270 days in humans to 645 days for African elephants, while months, or even just days, are of interest during the fastest spells of postnatal growth. That is particularly the case when meat-producing poultry, pigs, and cattle are fed optimized diets in order to maximize daily weight gain and to raise their mass to expected slaughter weight in the shortest possible time. Months and then years are the normal span of interest when monitoring growth of infants and children, and a pediatrician will compare age and sex-specific charts of expected growth with actual individual growth to determine if a baby or a toddler is meeting its growth milestones or if it is failing to thrive fully. Although the growth of some artifacts, be they sailing ships or construction cranes, must be traced across millennia, most of the advances have been concentrated in relatively brief growth spurts, separated by long periods of no growth or marginal gains. Energy converters, engines, turbines, motors, machines, and devices characteristic of modern industrial civilization have much shorter life histories. Growth of steam engines lasted 200 years from the early 18th to the early 20th century. Growth of steam turbines and electric motors has been going on since the 1880s, that of gas turbines only since the late 1930s. Growth of modern solid-state electronics began with the first commercial applications of the 1950s, but it really took off only with microprocessor-based designs starting in the 1970s. Studying the collective growth of our species in its evolutionary entirety would take us back some 200,000 years, but our ability to reconstruct the growth of the global population with a fair degree of accuracy goes back only to the early modern era, 1500 to 1800, and totals with small ranges of uncertainty have been available only for the past century. In a few countries with a history of censuses, however incomplete, with the counts often restricted to only adult males, or with availability of other documentary evidence, birth certificates maintained by parishes, we can recreate revealing population growth trajectories going back to the medieval period. In economic affairs, the unfolding growth of GDP, employment, productivity, output of specific items, is often followed in quarterly intervals, but statistical compendia report nearly all variables in terms of their annual totals or gains. Calendar year is the standard choice of time span, but the two most common instances of such departures are fiscal years and crop years, starting at various months, used to report annual harvests and yields. Some studies have tried to reconstruct national economic growth going back for centuries, even for millennia, but, as I will emphasize later, they belong more appropriately to the class of qualitative impressions rather than to the category of true quantitative appraisals. Reliable historical reconstructions for societies with adequate statistical services go back only 150 to 200 years. Growth rates capture the change of a variable during a specified time span, with percent per year being the most common metric. Unfortunately, these frequently cited values are often misleading. No caveats are needed only if these rates refer to linear growth, that is to adding identical quantity during every specified period. But when these rates refer to periods of exponential growth, they could be properly assessed only when it is understood that they are temporary values. While the most common varieties of growth encountered in nature and throughout civilization, those following various S-shaped patterns, are changing their growth rate constantly, from very low rates to a peak and back to very low rates as the growth process approaches its end. Figures of merit. There is no binding classification of the measures used to quantify growth. The most obvious basic division is into variables tracing physical changes and immaterial but quantifiable, at least by proxy if not in a direct manner, developments. The simplest entry in the first category is the increment of a studied variable counted on hourly, daily, monthly, or annual basis. And when statisticians talk about quantifying the growth of assorted populations, they use the term beyond its strict Latin meaning in order to refer to assemblages of microbes, plants, and animals, indeed to any quantifiable entities whose growth they wish to study. As for the fundamental quantities whose growth defines the material world, the International System of Units, Système International d'Unité, SI, recognizes 7 basic entries. They are length, meter, m, mass, kilogram, kg, time, second, s, electric current, ampere, a, thermodynamic temperature, kelvin, k, the amount of substance, mole, mol, and luminous intensity, candela, cd. Many growth measures deal with quantities derived from the 7 basic units, including area, square meter, volume, cubic meter, speed, meters per second, mass density, kilograms per cubic meter, and specific volume, cubic meters per kilogram. More complex quantity equations yield such common measures of growth as force, pressure, energy, power, or luminous flux. Most of these measures will be encountered repeatedly throughout this book, and their complete list, as well as the list of their multiples and submultiples, are available in units and abbreviations. The 2 basic units, length and mass, will be used to evaluate the growth of organisms, be they trees, invertebrates, or babies, structures, and machines. Height has been always the most appreciated, admired, and emulated among the linear variables. This preference is demonstrated in ways ranging from clear correlations between height and power in the corporate world to the obsession of architects and developers with building ever taller structures. There is no international organization monitoring the growth of buildings with the largest footprint or the largest internal space, but there is the Council on Tall Buildings and Human Habitat with its specific criteria for defining and measuring tall buildings. Their record heights rose from 42 meters for the Home Insurance Building, the world's first skyscraper, completed in 1884 in Chicago, to 828 meters for Burj Khalifa in Dubai, finished in 2009. Jeddah Tower, whose principal building contractor is Saudi Bin Laden Company, whose family name will always be connected to 9/11, will reach 1,008 meters by 2019. Length as height rather than mass has been also a recurrent topic of comparative anthropometric studies, and Clio Infra and Roser provide convenient summaries of height measurements ranging from those of ancient skeletons to modern humans, figure 1.1. Height of European military recruits provides some of the most reliable testimonies of human growth during the early modern and modern eras. Area appears in growth studies frequently on its own, in instances as diverse as the average size of farms, expansion of empires, and annual installation of photovoltaic panels to generate solar electricity. Changes in housing development, average areas of houses or apartments, are measured in square meters, except for the non-metric United States, where square feet are still used. Square kilometers, 1,000 by 1,000 meters, are used in tracing the growth of states and empires. Area is used even more commonly as the denominator to quantify productivity of photosynthetic output, that is, yields and harvests in forestry and agriculture. Hectares, 100 times 100 meters, or 10,000 square meters, are the most common aerial unit in agricultural statistics, except again for the non-metric U.S., where acres are still used. Volume is preferred to mass when surveying the growth of production and intake of both alcoholic and non-alcoholic beverages, usually in liters, and measuring annual cutting and industrial use of lumber and other wood products, usually in cubic meters. Volume has been also the indicator of choice when extracting and transporting crude oil, and it is also perhaps the best example of the endurance of a non-metric measure. A steel container with the volume of 42 U.S. gallons, or roughly 159.997 liters, was adopted by the U.S. Bureau of the Census in 1872 to measure crude oil output, and barrel remains the standard output measure in the oil industry. But converting this volume variable to its mass equivalent requires the knowledge of specific densities. Just over 6 barrels of heavy crude oil, commonly extracted in the Middle East, are needed to make up 1 ton of crude oil, but the total may be as high as 8.5 barrels for the lightest crudes produced in Algeria and Malaysia, with 7.33 barrels per ton being a commonly used global average. Similarly, converting volumes of wood to mass equivalents requires the knowledge of specific wood density. Even for commonly used species, densities differ by up to a factor of 2, from light pines, 400 kilograms per cubic meter, to heavy white ash, 800 kilograms per cubic meter, and the extreme wood densities range from less than 200 kilograms per cubic meter for balsa to more than 1.2 tons per cubic meter for ebony. The history of ubiquitous artifacts illustrates 2 opposite mass trends: miniaturization of commonly used components and devices on one hand, a trend enabled to an unprecedented degree by the diffusion of solid-state electronics, and a substantial increase in the average mass of the 2 largest investments modern families make, cars and houses, on the other. The declining mass of computers is obviously just an inverse of their growing capability to handle information per unit of weight. In August 1969, the Apollo 11 computer used to land the manned capsule on the moon weighed 32 kilograms and had merely 2 kilobytes of random access memory, RAM, or about 62 bytes per kilogram of mass. 12 years later, IBM's first personal computer weighed 11.3 kilograms and had 16 kilobytes RAM, that is 1.416 kilobytes per kilogram. In 2018, the Dell laptop used to write this book weighed 2.83 kilograms and had 4 gigabytes RAM, or 1.41 gigabytes per kilogram. Leaving the Apollo machine aside, one-of-a-kind, non-commercial design, personal computers have seen a million-fold growth of memory-to-mass ratio since 1981. As electronics, except for wall-sized televisions, got smaller, houses and cars got bigger. People think about houses primarily in terms of habitable area, but its substantial increase, in the U.S. from 91 square meters of finished area, 99 square meters total, in 1950, to about 240 square meters by 2015, has resulted in an even faster growth rate for materials used to build and to furnish them. A new 240 square meter house will need at least 35 tons of wood, roughly split between framing lumber and other wood products, including plywood, glulam, and veneer. In contrast, a simple 90-square-meter house could be built with no more than 12 tons of wood, a threefold difference. Moreover, modern American houses contain more furniture, and they have more and larger major appliances, refrigerators, dishwashers, washing machines, clothes dryers, while in 1950, only about 20% of households had washing machines, less than 10% owned clothes dryers, and less than 5% had air conditioning, now standard even in the northernmost states. In addition, heavier materials are used in more expensive finishes, including tiles and stone for flooring and bathrooms, stone kitchen counters, and large fireplaces. As a result, new houses built in 2015 are about 2.6 times larger than was the 1950 average, but for many of them, the massive materials required to build them is 4 times as large. The increasing mass of American passenger cars has resulted from a combination of desirable improvements and wasteful changes, figure 1.2. The world's first mass-produced car, Ford's famous Model T, released in October 1908, weighed just 540 kilograms. Weight gains after World War I, WW1, were due to fully enclosed all-metal bodies, heavier engines, and better seats. By 1938, the mass of Ford's Model 74 reached 1,090 kilograms, almost exactly twice that of the Model T. These trends, larger cars, heavier engines, more accessories, continued after World War II, WW2, and after a brief pause and retreat brought by the oil price rises by the Organization of the Petroleum Exporting Countries, OPEC, in the 1970s, intensified after the mid-1980s with the introduction of sport utility vehicles, SUVs, accounting for half of new U.S. vehicle sales in 2019, and the growing popularity of pickup trucks and vans. In 1981, the average mass of American cars and light trucks was 1,452 kilograms. By the year 2000, it had reached 1,733 kilograms, and by 2008, it was 1,852 kilograms, and had hardly changed by 2015, a 3.4-fold increase of average vehicle mass in 100 years. Average car mass growth in Europe and Asia has been somewhat smaller in absolute terms, but the growth rates have been similar to the U.S. rise. And while the worldwide car sales were less than 100,000 vehicles in 1908, they were more than 73 million in 2017, roughly a 700-fold increase. This means that the total mass of new automobiles sold globally every year is now about 2,500 larger than it was a century ago. Time is the third ubiquitous basic unit. Time is used to quantify growth directly, from increased human longevity to the duration of the longest flights, or as time elapsed between product failures that informs us about the durability and reliability of devices. More importantly, time is used as the denominator to express such ubiquitous rates as speed, length over time, meters per second, power, energy over time, joules per second, average earnings, money over time, dollars per hour, or national annual gross domestic product, total value of goods and services over time, dollars per year. Rising temperatures are encountered less frequently in growth studies, but they mark the still improving performance of turbo generators, while growing total luminosity of illumination informs about the widespread and intensifying problem of light pollution. Modern societies have been increasingly concerned about immaterial variables whose growth trajectories describe changing levels of economic performance, affluence, and quality of life. Common variables that the economists want to see growing include the total industrial output, GDP, disposable income, labor productivity, exports, trade surplus, labor force participation, and total employment. Affluence, GDP, gross earnings, disposable income, accumulated wealth, is commonly measured in per capita terms, while the quality of life is assessed by combinations of socioeconomic variables. For example, the Human Development Index, HDI, developed and annually recalculated by the United Nations Development Program, is composed of three indices quantifying life expectancy, educational level, and income. And in 2017, the World Economic Forum introduced a new Inclusive Development Index, IDI, based on a set of key performance indicators that allow a multidimensional assessment of living standards not only according to their current level of development, but also taking into account the recent performance over 5 years. There is a great deal of overlap between HDI for 2016 and IDI for 2017. Their rankings share 6 among the top 10 countries: Norway, Switzerland, Iceland, Denmark, Netherlands, Australia. Perhaps the most interesting addition to this new accounting has been the quantifications of happiness or satisfaction with life. A small Himalayan Bhutan made news in 1972 when Jigme Singye Wangchuck, the nation's fourth king, proposed to measure the kingdom's progress by using the index of gross national happiness. Turning this appealing concept into an indicator that could be monitored periodically is a different matter. In any case, for the post-World War II U.S., we have a fairly convincing proof that happiness has not been a growth variable. Gallup pollsters have been asking Americans irregularly how happy they feel since 1948. In that year, 43% of Americans felt very happy. The measure's peak, at 55%, was in 2004. The low point came after 9/11 at 37%, but by 2006 it was 49%, hardly any change compared to more than half a century ago, 47% in 1952. Satisfaction with life is closely connected with a number of qualitative gains that are not easily captured by resorting to simple and the most commonly available quantitative measures. Nutrition and housing are certainly the best two examples of this reality. As important as it may be, tracing the growth of average daily per capita availability of food energy may deliver a misleadingly reassuring message. Dietary improvements have lifted food supply far above the necessary energy needs. They may have delivered a more than adequate amount of carbohydrates and lipids and may have satisfied the minimum levels of high-quality protein, but could still be short of essential micronutrients, vitamins and minerals. Most notably, low intakes of fruit and vegetables, the key sources of micronutrients, have been identified as a leading risk factor for chronic disease, but Siegel et al. Showed that in most countries, their supply falls below recommended levels. In 2009, the global shortfall was 22%, with median supply-to-need ratios being just 0.42 in low-income and 1.02 in affluent countries. During the early modern era, the rise of scientific methods of inquiry and the invention and deployment of new, powerful mathematical and analytical tools, calculus during the mid-17th century, advances in theoretical physics and chemistry, and the foundations of modern economic and demographic studies during the 19th century, made it eventually possible to analyze growth in purely quantitative terms and to use relevant growth formulas in order to predict long-term trajectories of studied phenomena. Robert Malthus, 1766 to 1834, a pioneer of demographic and economic studies, caused a great amount of concern with his conclusion contrasting the means of subsistence that grow only at a linear rate with the growth of populations that proceeds at exponential rates. Unlike Malthus, Pierre-François Verhulst, 1804 to 1849, a Belgian mathematician, is now known only to historians of science, statisticians, demographers, and biologists. But four decades after Malthus's essay, Verhulst made a fundamental contribution to our understanding of growth when he published the first realistic formulas devised explicitly to express the progress of confined, bounded growth. Such growth governs not only the development of all organisms, but also the improving performance of new techniques, diffusion of many innovations, and adoption of many consumer products. Before starting my topical coverage of growth phenomena and their trajectories in Chapter 2, I will provide brief but fairly comprehensive introductions into the nature of these formal growth patterns and resulting growth curves. Linear and exponential growth. These are two common but very different forms of growth whose trajectories are captured by simple equations. Relatively slow and steady would be the best qualitative description of the former, and increasingly rapid and eventually soaring, the best of the latter. Anything subject to linear growth increases by the same amount during every identical period, and hence the equation for linear growth is simple. N sub t equals n sub 0 plus kt, where a quantity at time t, n sub t, is calculated by enlarging the initial value, n sub 0, by the addition of a constant value k per unit of time t. Analysis of a large number of stalagmites shows that these tapering columns of calcium salts created on cave floors by dripping water often grow for millennia in a near-linear fashion. Even a relatively fast growth of 0.1 millimeters a year would mean that a stalagmite 1 meter tall would grow just 10 centimeters in 1,000 years, 1,000 millimeters plus 1,000 times 0.1. The plotted outcome of its linear growth shows a monotonously ascending line, figure 1.3. This, of course, means that the growth rate as the share of the total stalagmite height will be constantly declining. In a stalagmite growing at 0.1 millimeters a year for 1,000 years, it would be 0.01% during the first year, but only 0.009% a millennium later. In contrast, in all cases of exponential growth, the quantity increases by the same rate during every identical period. The basic functional dependence is n sub t equals n sub 0 multiplied by the sum of 1 plus r to the power of t, where r is the rate of growth expressed as a fraction of unity growth per unit time. For example, for a 7% increase per unit of time, r equals 0.07. This exponential growth can be also expressed, after a trivial multiplicative unit of timekeeping adjustment, as n sub t equals n sub 0 multiplied by e to the power of rt, where e equals 2.7183, the base of natural logarithms, is raised to the power of rt, an easy operation to do with any scientific hand calculator. We can imagine a cave where the amount of dripping water carrying the same fraction of dissolved salts keeps on increasing, resulting in an exponential growth of a stalagmite. Assuming a very small 0.05% fractional length increase per year, this stalagmite would have lengthened by nearly 65 centimeters in 1,000 years, 1,000 millimeters times 2.718 to the power of 0.0005 times 1,000 equals 1,648.6 millimeters total length, or a length increase of 64.86 centimeters, about 50% more than its linearly growing counterpart, and the plotted exponential growth shows an upward bending curve whose ascent is determined by the rate of increase, figure 1.3. After 10,000 years, the linear stalagmite would double its height to 2 meters, while the exponentially growing stalagmite would need a giant cave as it would reach 148.3 meters. As the exponent is the product of growth rate and time, equally large additions can come from lower growth rates over longer intervals of time or from shorter intervals of higher growth rates. Another simple comparison shows how the trajectories of linear and exponential growth remain close only during the earliest stage of growth, when the product of growth rate and time interval is small compared to unity. Soon, they begin to diverge, and eventually they are far apart. Gold assumed that bacterial colonies living deep underground fill up to 1% of all porous spaces in the topmost 5 kilometers of the Earth's crust, while Whitman et al. Put the microbe fillable volume at just 0.016% of the available porous space. That would still translate into enormous aggregate microbial mass, but one with exceedingly slow rates of reproduction. Let us assume, just for the sake of this simple example, that the physical and chemical constraints make it possible for a tiny colony of 100 cells, suddenly squeezed by a seismic event into a new rock pocket, to make the net addition of just 5 cells per hour. Obviously, there will be 105 cells at the end of the first hour. After 10 hours of such linear growth, the colony will have 150 cells, and the respective totals will be 350 and 600 cells after 50 and 100 hours. In comparison to many common bacteria, Mycobacterium tuberculosis, a remarkably prevalent cause of premature mortality in the pre-antibiotic era, and still one of the single largest causes of human mortality due to infectious disease, and the cause of what are now some of the most drug-resistant forms of such disease, reproduces slowly in most circumstances in infected human lungs. But when growing on suitable laboratory substrates, it will double its cell count in 15 hours, implying an hourly growth rate of roughly 5%. Starting, again, with 100 cells, there will be 105 cells at the end of the first hour, the same as with the linear growth of subterranean microbes. After 10 hours of exponential growth, the colony will have 165 cells, just 10% more than in the linear case. But the exponential totals will be 1,218 cells after 50 hours, roughly 3.5 times as much as in the linear case, and 14,841 cells after 100 hours, almost 25 times more. The contrast is obvious. Without a priori knowledge, we could not tell the difference after the first hour. But after 100 hours, the gap has become enormous, as the exponential count is an order of magnitude higher. Instances of linear, constant growth are ubiquitous. Distance, length, traveled by light emitted by myriads of stars, increases by 300 million meters, 299,792,458 meters to be exact, every second. Distance covered by a truck, averaging 100 kilometers per hour on a nighttime freeway, grows by 27.7 meters during the same time. According to Ohm's law, voltage, volts, V, equals current, amperes, A, times the resistance, ohms, omega, of the conducting circuit. When resistance remains constant, current increases linearly with increasing voltage. Fixed and untaxed hourly wage will bring a linear increase of salary with longer work time. Cell phone use, charged per minute, rather than on an unlimited plan, will produce a linearly increasing monthly bill with linearly increasing chatter. In nature, linear growth is often encountered temporarily during the early stages of postnatal development, be it of piglets or children. Increasing life expectancies in affluent countries have followed it for more than a century, and it is the only long-term growth trajectory for rising crop yields, be it of staple grains or fruits. Improvements in the ratings and capabilities of machines have been often linear, including the average power of American cars since the Ford Model T in 1908, maximum thrust and bypass ratio of jet engines since their origin, maximum train speed and boiler pressure of steam locomotives since the beginning of regular service in 1830, and maximum ship displacements. And sometimes simple linear growth is an outcome of complex interactions. Between 1945 and 1978, U.S. gasoline consumption had followed an almost perfectly linear course, and after a brief four-year dip, it resumed a slower linear growth in 1983 that continued until 2007. The two linear trajectories resulted from an interplay of nonlinear changes as vehicle ownership soared, increasing more than seven times between 1945 and 2015, while average fuel-using efficiency of automotive engines remained stagnant until 1977, then improved significantly between 1978 and 1985, before becoming, once again, stagnant for the next 25 years. Some organisms, including bacteria cultivated in the laboratory and young children, experience periods of linear growth, adding the same number of new cells or the same height or the same mass increment during specific periods of time. Bacteria follow that path when provided with a limited but constant supply of a critical nutrient. Children have spells of linear growth both for weight and height. For example, American boys have brief periods of linear weight growth between 21 and 36 months of age, and the child growth standards of the World Health Organization, WHO, indicate a perfectly linear growth of height with age for boys between 3 and 5 years, and an almost linear trajectory for girls between the same ages. Exponential growth. Exponential growth, with its gradual takeoff followed by a steep rise, attracts attention. Properties of this growth, formerly known as geometric ratio or geometric progression, have been illustrated for hundreds of years, perhaps for millennia, although the first written instance comes only from the year 1256, by referring to the request of a man who invented chess and asked his ruler patron to reward him by doubling the number of grains of rice, or wheat, laid on every square. The total of 128 grains, 2 to the 7th, is still trivial at the end of the first row. There are about 2.1 billion grains, 2 to the 31st, when reaching the end of the middle, 4th row, and at the end, it amounts to about 9.2 quintillion, 9.2 times 10 to the 18th grains. The key characteristic of advanced exponential growth are the soaring additions that entirely overwhelm the preceding totals. Additions to the last row of the chessboard are 256 times larger than the total accumulated at the end of the penultimate row, and they represent 99.61% of all added grains. Obviously, undesirable exponential growth may be arrested, with various degrees of effort in its early stages, but the task may quickly become unmanageable as the growth continues. When assuming an average rice grain mass of 25 milligrams, the grand total, all too obviously not able to fit any chessboard, would equal about 230 gigatons of rice, nearly 500 times more than the grain's global annual harvest, which was just short of 500 megatons in 2015. Over long periods, even minuscule growth rates will produce impossible outcomes, and there is no need to invoke any cosmic time spans. Referring back to antiquity will do. When Imperial Rome reached its apogee in the second century of the Common Era, it needed to harvest about 12 megatons of grain, much of it grown in Egypt and shipped to Italy, in order to sustain its population of some 60 million people. When assuming that Rome would have endured and that its grain harvest would have grown at a mere 0.5% a year its total would have now reached about 160 gigatons, or more than 60 times the world's grain harvest of 2.5 gigatons in 2015, used to feed more than 7 billion people. Linear scale is a poor choice for charting exponential growth whose complete trajectory often encompasses many orders of magnitude. In order to accommodate the entire range on a linear y-axis, it becomes impossible to make out any actual values except for the largest order of magnitude, and the result is always a J-curve that has a nearly linear section of relatively slow gains followed by a more or less steep ascent. In contrast, plotting constant exponential growth on a semi-logarithmic graph, with linear x-axis for time and logarithmic y-axis for the growing quantity, produces a perfectly straight line, and actual values can be easily read off the y-axis even when the entire growth range spans many orders of magnitude. Making a semi-log plot is thus an easy graphic way of identifying if a given set of data has been a result of exponential growth. Figure 1.5 compares the two plots for such a phenomenon. It charts the growth of one of the key foundations of modern civilization, the almost perfectly exponential rise of global crude oil consumption between 1880 and 1970. The fuel's commercial production began on a negligible scale in only three countries, in Russia, starting in 1846, and in Canada and the U.S., starting in 1858 and 1859. By 1875, it was still only about 2 megatons, and then, as U.S. and Russian extraction expanded and as other producers entered the market, Romania, Indonesia, Burma, Iran, the output grew exponentially to about 170 megatons by 1930. The industry was briefly slowed down by the economic crisis of the 1930s, but its exponential rise resumed in 1945 and, propelled by new huge Middle Eastern and Russian discoveries, by the mid-1970s, the output was three orders of magnitude, slightly more than 1,000 times, higher than 100 years previous. Temporary periods of exponential growth have not been uncommon in modern economies, where they have marked the rise of domestic product in such rapidly developing nations as Japan, South Korea, and post-1985 China, and where they characterized annual sales of electronic consumer goods whose mass appeal created new global markets. And, of course, fraudulent investing schemes, Ponzi pyramids, are built on the allure of the temporary exponential rise of make-believe earnings. Arresting exponential growth in its early stages can be done in manageable manner. Sudden collapse of Ponzi-like growth will always have undesirable consequences. Progress of technical advances has been also often marked by distinct exponential spells, but when the exponential growth and its perils became a major topic of public discourse for the first time, it was in relation to rising sizes of populations. That famous work, An Essay on the Principle of Population, by Thomas Robert Malthus, had precedence in the work of Leonhard Euler, a leading scientist of the 18th century who left Switzerland to work in Russia and Prussia. In Berlin, after his return from Russia, Euler published, in Latin, at that time still the standard language of scientific writing, Introduction to Analysis of the Infinite. Among the problems addressed in the book was one inspired by Berlin's 1747 population census, which counted more than 100,000 people. Euler wanted to know how large such a population, growing annually by 1/30, 3.33% a year, would be in 100 years. His answer, determined by the use of logarithms, was that it could grow more than 25 times in a century. As p sub n equals p sub 0, multiplied by the sum of 1 plus r to the power of n, the total in 100 years will be 100,000 multiplied by the sum of 1 plus 1 over 30 to the 100th power, or 2,654,874. Euler then proceeded to show how to calculate the annual rate of population increase and the doubling periods. But it was Malthus who elevated the powers of exponential growth to a major concern of the new disciplines of demography and political economy. His much-repeated conclusion was that the power of population is indefinitely greater than the power in the earth to produce subsistence for man, because the unchecked population would be rising exponentially, while its means of subsistence would be growing linearly. Taking the population of the world at any number, 1,000 millions, for instance, the human species would increase in the ratio of 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, 128, 256, 512, etc., and subsistence as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, etc. In 2 centuries and a quarter, the population would be to the means of subsistence as 512 to 10, in 3 centuries as 4,096 to 13, and in 2,000 years the difference would be almost incalculable, though the produce in that time would have increased to an immense extent. Charles Darwin illustrated the process with references to Malthus and Linnaeus, and with his own calculation of the consequences of unchecked elephant breeding. There is no exception to the rule that every organic being increases at so high a rate that if not destroyed, the earth would soon be covered by the progeny of a single pair. Even slow-breeding man has doubled in 25 years, and at this rate, in a few thousand years, there would literally not be standing room for his progeny. Linnaeus has calculated that if an annual plant produced only 2 seeds, and there is no plant so unproductive as this, and their seedlings next year produced 2, and so on, then in 20 years there would be 1,000,000 plants. The elephant is reckoned to be the slowest breeder of all known animals, and I have taken some pains to estimate its probable minimum rate of natural increase. It will be under the mark to assume that it breeds when 30 years old and goes on breeding till 90 years old, bringing forth 3 pairs of young in this interval. If this be so, at the end of the 5th century there would be alive 15,000,000 elephants, descended from the first pair. As I will explain in detail in the chapters on the growth of organisms and artifacts, these specific calculations have to be understood with the right mixture of concern and dismissal, but they share 2 fundamental attributes. First, and unlike with linear growth, where the absolute increment per unit of time remains the same, exponential growth results in increasing absolute gains per unit of time as the base gets larger. The U.S. economy grew by 5.5% in 1957 as well as in 1970, but in the second instance, the absolute gain was 2.27 times larger, $56 versus $24.7 billion. In most of the commonly encountered cases of exponential growth, the rate of increase is not perfectly constant. It either trends slightly over time or it fluctuates around a long-term mean. A slowly declining growth rate will produce less pronounced exponential gains. Decadal means of U.S. GDP growth since 1970 are a good example. They declined from 9.5% during the 1970s to 7.7% during the 1980s, 5.3% during the 1990s, and to just 4% during the first decade of the 21st century. An increasing growth rate will result in a super-exponential pace of increase. Growth of China's real GDP between 1996 and 2010 was super-exponential. The annual rate was 8.6% during the first 5 years, 9.8% between 2001 and 2005, and 11.3% between 2006 and 2010. Fluctuating growth rates are the norm with the long-term expansion of economies. For example, U.S. economic growth, expressed as GDP, averaged 7% a year during the second half of the 20th century, but that compounded mean rate of change hides substantial annual fluctuations, with the extreme rates at minus 0.3% in 1954, the only year of GDP decline, and 13% in 1978. Second, exponential growth, natural or anthropogenic, is always only a temporary phenomenon, to be terminated due to a variety of physical, environmental, economic, technical, or social constraints. Nuclear chain reactions end as surely, due to the limited mass of fissile material, as do Ponzi, pyramid investment schemes, once the inflow of new monies sinks below the redemptions. But in the latter case, it can take a while. Think of Bernard Madoff, who was able to carry on his fraudulent activities, a Ponzi scheme so elaborate that it had eluded the oversight authorities who had repeatedly investigated his company, although certainly not as diligently as they should have, for more than 30 years, and to defraud about $65 billion from his investors before he was finally undone by the greatest post-World War II economic crisis in the fall of 2008. This is why it can be so misleading to use exponential growth for longer-term forecasting. This could be illustrated by any number of examples based on actual histories, and I have chosen the impressive growth of America's post-1950 airline passenger traffic. During the 1950s, its annual exponential growth averaged 11.1%, and the rates for the 1960s and the 1970s were, respectively, 12.4% and 9.4%. A plot of the annual totals of passenger kilometers flown by all U.S. airlines between 1930 and 1980 produces a trajectory that is almost perfectly captured by a quartic regression, fourth-order polynomial with r squared equals 0.9998, and continuation of this growth pattern would have multiplied the 1980 level almost 10 times by 2015, figure 1.6. In reality, U.S. airline traffic has followed a trajectory of declining growth, with average annual growth of just 0.9% during the first decade of the 21st century, and its complete 1930 to 2015 course fits very well into a four-parameter, symmetric, logistic curve, with the 2015 total only about 2.3 times higher than in 1980, and with only limited further gain expected by 2030, figure 1.6. Taking temporarily high rates of annual exponential growth as indicators of future long-term developments is a fundamental mistake, but also an enduring habit that is especially favored by uncritical promoters of new devices, designs, or practices. They take early-stage growth rates, often impressively exponential, and use them to forecast an imminent dominance of emerging phenomena. Many recent examples can illustrate this error, and I have chosen the capacity growth of Vestas wind turbines, machines leading the shift toward the decarbonization of global electricity generation. This Danish maker began its sales with a 55-kilowatt machine in 1981. By 1989, it had a turbine capable of 225 kilowatts, a 600-kilowatt machine was introduced in 1995, and a 2-megawatt unit followed in 1999. The best fit curve for this rapid growth trajectory of the last two decades of the 20th century, 5-parameter logistic fit with r squared of 0.978, would have predicted designs with capacity of nearly 10 megawatts in 2005 and in excess of 100 megawatts by 2015. But in 2018, the largest Vestas unit available for onshore installations was 4.2 megawatts, and the largest unit suitable for offshore wind farms was 8 megawatts, that could be upgraded to 9 megawatts. and it is most unlikely that a 100-megawatt machine will be ever built. This example of a sobering contrast between early rapid advances of a technical innovation followed by inevitable formation of sigmoid curves should be recalled whenever you see news reports about all cars becoming electric by 2025 or new batteries having impressively higher energy densities by 2030. But the final, inescapable power of this reality may seem inapplicable in those cases where exponential growth has been underway for an extended period of time and when it keeps setting new record levels. More than a few normally rational people have been able to convince themselves, by repeating the mantra, "This time it is different," that performances will keep on multiplying for a long time to come. The best examples of these often collective delusions come from the history of stock market bubbles, and I will describe in some detail just two most notable recent events, Japan's pre-1990 rise and America's new economy of the 1990s. Japan's economic rise during the 1980s provides one of the best examples of people who should know better getting carried away by the power of exponential growth. After growing 2.6 times during the 1970s, Nikkei 225, Japan's leading stock market index and the country's equivalent of America's Dow Jones Industrial, increased by 184% between January 1981 and 1986, added 43% in 1986, nearly 13% in 1987, almost 43% in 1988, and a further 29% in 1989. Between January 1981 and December 1989, Nikkei 225 had more than quintupled, the performance corresponding to average annual exponential growth of 17% for the decade and 24% for its second half. Concurrently, Japan's GDP kept on growing at an annual rate surpassing 4%, as the yen's exchange rate strengthened from 239 yen per U.S. dollar in January 1980 to 143 yen per U.S. dollar by December 1989. A sobering denouement had to come, and in Chapter 6 I will trace that swift post-1989 unfolding. But exponential growth is a potent delusion maker, and in 1999, 10 years after the Nikkei's peak, I was thinking about the Japanese experience as we were waiting to claim our rental car at San Francisco Airport. Silicon Valley was years into its first dot-com bubble, and even with advance reservations, people had to wait for the just-returned cars to get serviced and released again into the halting traffic on the clogged Bayshore Freeway. Mindful of the Japanese experience, I was thinking that every year after 1995 might be the last spell of what Alan Greenspan famously called irrational exuberance, but it was not in 1996 or 1997 or 1998. And even more so than a decade earlier, there were many economists ready to assure American investors that this spell of exponential growth was really different, that the old rules do not apply in the new economy, where endless rapid growth will readily continue. During the 1990s, the Dow Jones Industrial Average, driven by America's supposedly new economy, posted the biggest decadal gain in history, as it rose from 2,810 at the beginning of January 1990 to 11,497 at the end of December 1999. The performance corresponded to annual exponential growth of 14% during the decade, with the peak gains of 33% in 1995 and 25% in 1996. Continuation of that growth pointed to a level around 30,000 by 2010, and the NASDAQ Composite Index, reflecting the rising computing and communication capabilities, and above all, the soaring performance of speculation-driven Silicon Valley companies, did even better during the 1990s, Its exponential growth averaged almost 26% annually between April 1991, when it reached 5,000 points, and March 9, 2000, when it peaked at 5,046 points. Even some normally cautious observers got swept away by this. Jeremy Siegel at the Wharton School of Business marveled, "It's amazing. Every year we say it can't be another year of 20% plus gains, and then every year it's 20% plus. I still maintain we have to get used to lower, more normal returns, but who knows when this streak is going to end." And the boosters made money by wholesaling the impossible. One bestseller saw an early arrival of Dow Jones at 40,000. Another forecast the unstoppable coming of Dow 100,000. But the end came, and again it was fairly swift. By September of 2002, Dow Jones was down to 9,945, a nearly 40% decline from its 1999 peak, and by May 2002, NASDAQ composite fell nearly 77% from its March 2000 peak. Exponential growth has been common in many cases of technical advances, and as I will show in Chapter 3, in some instances it has persisted for decades. The maximum power of steam turbines is a perfect example of this long-lasting exponential growth. Charles Algernon Parsons patented the first design in 1884 and almost immediately built a small machine, which can be seen in the lobby of the Parsons building at Trinity College in Dublin, with power of just 7.5 kilowatts. But the first commercial turbine was 10 times larger, as the 75-kilowatt machine began generating electricity in 1890. The subsequent rapid rise brought the first 1-megawatt turbine by 1899, a 2-megawatt machine just 3 years later, the first 5-megawatt design in 1907, and before World War I, the maximum capacity reached 25 megawatts, with the turbine installed at the Fisk Street station of the Commonwealth Edison Company in Chicago. Between the first year of the first commercial 75-kilowatt model in 1890 and the 25-megawatt machine of 1912, maximum capacities of Parsons' steam turbines were thus growing at an annual compounded exponential rate of more than 26%, doubling in less than 3 years. That was considerably faster than the growth of early steam engine capacities during the 18th century, or the rated power of water turbines since the 1830s, when Benoît Fulnayron commercialized his first designs. And some performances advance exponentially, not by a constant improvement of the original technique, but by a series of innovations, with the next innovation stage taking off where the old technique reached its limits. Individual growth trajectories are unmistakably S-shaped, but their envelope charts an exponential ascent. The history of vacuum tubes, briefly reviewed in Chapter 4, is an excellent example of such an exponential envelope spanning nearly a century of advances. In Chapter 4, on the growth of artifacts, I will also look in detail at perhaps the most famous case of modern exponential growth that has been sustained for 50 years, that of the crowding of transistors on a silicon microchip described by Moore's law that has doubled the number of components every 2 years. And before leaving the topic of exponential growth, this is an apposite place to note a simple rule for calculating the doubling period of quantities subject to it, be they cancerous cells, bank accounts, or the processing capacity of computers, or, in reverse, to calculate a growth rate by using the known doubling time. Exact results are obtained by dividing the natural logarithm of 2, that is 0.693, by the prevailing growth rate, expressed as a fraction of 1, for example, 0.1 for 10%, but a quite good approximation is dividing 70 by the growth rate expressed in percent. When the Chinese economy was growing at 10% a year, its doubling period was 7 years. Conversely, the doubling of components on a microchip in 2 years implies an annual exponential growth rate of about 35%. Hyperbolic growth. Unbounded, and hence on Earth always only temporary, exponential growth should not be mistaken, as it sometimes is, for hyperbolic growth. While exponential progress is characterized by an increasing absolute rate of growth, it remains a function of time as it approaches infinity. In contrast, hyperbolic growth culminates in an absurdity as a quantity grows toward infinity in a finite time interval, figure 1.7. This terminal event is, of course, impossible within any finite confines, and a moderating feedback will eventually exert a damping effect and terminate the hyperbolic progress. But when starting at low rates, hyperbolic trajectories may be sustained for relatively long periods of time before their progression stops and another form of growth or decline takes over. Caillou was the first to note what he called the surexpansion, the fact that the global population was growing at an ever-increasing rate, the process made possible by an accelerated evolution of civilizations. Ainsi est-il normal de lier la surexpansion humaine à la présence de l'esprit? This process fits a quasi-hyperbolic equation. P equals A divided by the sum of D minus T multiplied by M, where A, D, and M are constants. Meyer and Vallée thus concluded that the growth of human population, far from tending naturally toward an equilibrium state, exhibits a unique characteristic, that of self-acceleration. But only temporarily, as the projection of this growth would eventually lead to infinite population. Von Förster et al. Had actually calculated that Friday, the 13th of November, AD 2026, will be the doomsday when the human population will approach infinity if it grows as it has grown in the last two millennia. Obviously, that could never happen, and just a few years after von Förster et al. Published their paper, the annual growth of global population peaked and a transition to a new trajectory began. Even so, Hearn argued that global population growth had shown striking parallels with malignant growth because some cancers also display decreasing doubling times of cell proliferation during their most invasive phase. Starting the count 3 million years ago, he calculated that by 1998, the human population had undergone 32.5 doublings, with the 33rd reaching 8.59 billion, to be completed in the early 21st century. When adding biomass of domestic animals to the anthropomass, the 33rd doubling was already completed. Some malignant tumors cause death of the host organism after 37 to 40 doublings, and assuming the trend continues, the 37th doubling of the human population will be reached in a few hundred years. Nielsen's analysis of world population growth showed that there were actually three approximately determined episodes of hyperbolic growth during the past 12,000 years. The first one between 10,000 and 500 BCE, the second one between 500 and 1200 CE, and the third one between 1400 and 1950. In total, accounting for about 89% of total growth over the past 12 millennia. The first two transitions, 500 BC to 500 CE and 1200 to 1400, were considerable slowdowns between two hyperbolic trajectories, while the current transition is to an unknown trajectory. Will we see a relatively early leveling off, followed by a prolonged plateau, or a peak followed soon by a significant decline? I will have much more on the trajectories of population growth in chapters 5 and 6. There is another class of notable examples of anthropogenic hyperbolic growth, one that has been noted by many authors pointing out the instances of accelerating developments in history. These writings have a long pedigree. They began in the latter half of the 19th century and their notable 20th century editions include Henry Adams, French historians during the 1940s, and, starting during the 1950s, many American historians, physicists, technologists, and computer scientists. Adams wrote about a law of acceleration and about the rule of phase applied to history, which would eventually see human thought brought to the limit of its possibilities. Meyer and Alavi wrote about l'accélération évolutive and about l'accélération de l'histoire. Key contributions of the American wave, written from different perspectives, included Feynman, Moore, Peale, Moravec, Corin, and Kurzweil. Many of these writings either imply or explicitly posit the arrival of singularity when the contributions of artificial superintelligence will rise to such a level that they will be transformed into an unprecedented runaway process. This implies not only artificial intelligence surpassing any human capabilities imaginable, but also coming ever closer to an instantaneous rate of physical change. Obviously, such achievements would utterly reform our civilization. Adams predicted, as he understood it, that is, excluding any computing dimensions, singularity's arrival sometime between 1921 and 2025. Corin put it off until 2140, and Kurzweil's latest prediction for artificial intelligence machines taking over is for 2045. While we are, as many of these writers assert, moving inexorably to that fantastic state, proponents of accelerating, that is, hyperbolic, growth point to such unfolding processes as our ability to feed increasing populations, to use ever more powerful prime energy converters, or to travel at ever higher speeds. This is manifested as a sequence of logistic curves, a phenomenon well described by Derek J. DeSola Price. The newly felt constriction produces restorative reaction. If the reaction is successful, its value usually seems to lie in so transforming what is being measured that it takes a new lease on life and rises with a new vigor until at last it must meet its doom. One therefore finds two variants of the traditional logistic curve that are more frequent than the plain S-shaped ogive. In both cases, the variant sets in some time during the inflection, presumably at a time when the privations of the loss of exponential growth become unbearable. If a slight change of definition of the thing that is being measured can be so allowed as to count a new phenomenon on equal terms with the old, the new logistic curve rises phoenix-like on the ashes of the old. Meyer and Vallée argued that this phenomenon of logistic escalation or accelerating growth has been underestimated, and that hyperbolic rather than exponential growth is not uncommon when taking a long-term look at technical advances. Their examples of hyperbolic advances ranged from the number of individuals that could be supported by a unit of land to growth of maximum power of prime movers, speed of travel, and best efficiencies of energy conversion techniques. Historical growth of specific advances conforms to S-curves, logistic or other, with their inherent asymptotes. But the envelope of sequential gains makes the entire growth sequence temporarily hyperbolic. Echoing Price, Meyer and Vallée saw this relay process as an automatic sequence. As soon as it reaches its ceiling, another machine, in the sense of another qualitatively different technology, relays the previous one and goes through its ceiling, with the resulting effect of sustaining the acceleration of the quantitative variable. Closer looks reveal more complex realities. Foraging, practiced by early gatherers and hunters, could support as few as 0.0001 people per hectare of land, and typical rates in more hospitable environments were around 0.002 people per hectare. Shifting agriculture elevated that density by up to two orders of magnitude to 0.2 to 0.5 people per hectare. The first societies practicing permanent agriculture, Mesopotamia, Egypt, China, raised it to one person per hectare. The best 19th century traditional farming in such intensively cultivated places as southern China could support as many as 5 people per hectare, while modern farming can feed more than 10 people per hectare, and it does so by providing a much better average quality diet than did the previous arrangements. But this sequence does not describe any inexorably timed universal evolutionary progression, as in many regions, foraging coexisted for millennia with settled farming, and still does today. Think of collecting truffles and hunting wild pigs in Tuscany. As shifting agriculture was practiced even in parts of Europe, Scandinavia, Russia, well into the 20th century, and as it still supports millions of families throughout Latin America, Africa, and Asia, and as such hybrid practices as agro-pastoralism have remained common in those environments where they help to reduce the risk of an exclusive reliance on cropping. And, obviously, even if the best seeds are planted, and when the crop receives optimum nutrients, moisture, and protection against weeds and pests, the maximum yield remains limited by light intensity, length of the growing period, minimum temperature tolerated by the species, and the vulnerability to many kinds of natural catastrophes. As I will show in Chapter 2, in the section on crop growth, many regions of previously rising productivities now have diminished returns with intensive inputs of fertilizers and enhanced irrigation, and their yield trajectory has been one of minimal gains or outright stagnation. Clearly, there is no universal, super-exponential progression toward superior harvests. Human ingenuity has brought more impressive gains when it did not have to reckon with the complexities of organisms whose life cycles are determined by assorted environmental constraints. Technical advances provide the best examples of self-accelerating development following hyperbolic growth trajectories, and the maximum unit power of prime movers and top travel speeds offer accurately documented illustrations. The maximum unit power of modern prime movers, primary sources of mechanical power, shifted first from less than 1,000 watts for steam engines in the early 17th century to water turbines between 1850 and 1900, and then to steam turbines, whose record ratings now surpass 1 gigawatt, figure 1.8. Further extension could be made by including rocket engines deployed only for brief periods of time. Power of the Saturn C5 rocket that launched the Apollo mission to the moon was about 2.6 gigawatts. Similarly, maximum travel speeds increased from endurance running, 10 to 12 kilometers per hour sustained by messengers and riders on good horses, average speed 13 to 16 kilometers per hour, to fast sailing ships, mid-19th century clippers averaging around 20 kilometers per hour with top speeds above 30 kilometers per hour, trains, maxima of around 100 kilometers per hour reached before 1900, to commercial airplanes powered by reciprocating engines, speeds rising from 160 kilometers per hour in 1919 to 550 kilometers per hour in 1945, and finally to jetliners, more than 900 kilometers per hour since the late 1950s. In both instances, the accelerating growth has been achieved by the relay phenomenon, as the overlapping logistic, self-limiting curves produce an impressively ascending envelope. Obviously, this relay cannot continue because it would eventually produce impossibly high growth rates, be it of unit power or speed. As has been the case with global population growth, a temporary hyperbolic envelope will be eventually transformed to a logistic trajectory. In fact, this has already been the case when technical advances are considered in practical, realistic terms and not as sequences of maximum performances. Obviously, constructing the maximum speed envelope by overlapping logistic curves of speeds for horses, sailing ships, trains, cars, airplanes, and rockets shows a progression of transportation modes that is not sequentially substitutable. High-volume urban transport progressed from horse-drawn vehicles to motorized road vehicles and subways, but it will not progress to jet-powered flight. The opposite is true, as the average speed of urban traffic has declined in almost every major city since the 1960s, and just its doubling would be impossible even if every vehicle was part of a synchronized automated urban system. Unless all crossroads were eliminated, infrastructurally an impossible transformation in existing cities. The average speed of rapid trains has increased only marginally since their first deployment in 1964, and once again, it is a very safe bet that billions of people traveling by train will not do so in a decade or two in a supersonic hyperloop fashion. The typical speed of large container ships, 30 to 40 kilometers per hour, is not radically higher than the typical speed of the 19th century clippers. Of course, their cargo capacities are orders of magnitude apart, but there has been no hyperbolic growth of speeds in ocean shipping, and there is no realistic prospect that this fundamental mode of transport that enabled modern economic globalization will enter a new age of radically increased speeds. The cruising speed of the latest Boeing 787, 913 kilometers per hour, is nearly 7% lower than the cruising speed of the company's first commercial jetliner, Boeing 707, in 1958, 977 kilometers per hour. Again, there is no realistic prospect that billions of passengers will be soon casually traveling at supersonic speeds. The seemingly hyperbolic envelope of maximum performances tells us little about the actual trajectories of speeds that have created modern economies by moving billions of people and billions of tons of raw materials, foodstuffs, and finished products. The same is, inevitably, true about other envelopes of growing technical capabilities. The largest rockets may produce gigawatts of power during very brief periods of takeoff, but that is irrelevant as far as actual capacities of myriads of machines energizing modern civilization are concerned. Most electric motors in our appliances have power that is smaller than that delivered by a well-harnessed horse. Washing machines need 500 watts. A well-fed horse could easily sustain 800 watts. The typical or modal capacity of steam turbines in large electricity-generating stations has been fairly stable since the 1960s, with units of 200 to 600 megawatts dominant in new plants fired by coal or natural gas, and with turbogenerators larger than 1 gigawatt reserved mostly for the largest nuclear stations. And the power of typical road vehicles has gone up slightly only because they got heavier, not because they need to be more powerful to go from red light to red light or to cruise within posted speed limits on highways, for which a motive power of about 11 kilowatts per ton of vehicle weight is sufficient for 100 kilometers per hour travel on level roads. Again, a synthetic rising trajectory is composed of disparate progressions that do not imply any unified rising trend of ever-ascending substitutions. And there is no shortage of historical examples of technical advances that do not show any automatic, tightly sequenced acceleration of performance. Steelmakers continued to rely on open-hearth furnaces for nearly a century after they perfected their use, and the hard-wired rotary dial telephone changed little between its adoption during the 1920s and the introduction of the push-button design in 1963. And there is no doubt about the long-term trajectory of hyperbolic growth on the Earth. It must either collapse, or it must morph into a confined progression which might become a part of a homeostatic coexistence of humanity and the biosphere, including an eventual upper limit on the information content in the external memory. Confined growth patterns. These are, above all, the trajectories of life. The biosphere's mass of recyclable nutrients allows for an enormous variety of specific genetic expressions and mutations but it puts fundamental limits on the performance of primary production, photosynthesis, and hence on the accumulation of secondary production, heterotrophic metabolism of organisms ranging from microbes to the most massive mammals. These limits unfold through intra- and interspecific competition of microorganisms, plants, and animals for resources, through predation and viral, bacterial, and fungal infections, and all multicellular organisms are subject to intrinsic growth limits imposed by apoptosis, programmed cell death. No tree grows to heaven, but neither does any artifact, structure, or process, and confined or constrained growth patterns characterize the development of machines and technical capabilities as much as they describe the growth of populations and expansion of empires. And inevitably, all diffusion and adoption processes must conform to that general pattern, no matter if their early trajectory shows rapid or slow progress. It is eventually followed by a substantial slowdown in growth rate as the process asymptotically approaches saturation and often reaches it, sometimes after many decades of diffusion, only a few percent, even only a fraction of a percent, short of the maximum. No households had electricity in 1880, but how many urban dwellings in Western cities are not connected to the grid today? Given the ubiquity of phenomena exhibiting confined growth, it is not surprising that many investigators sought to fit them into a variety of mathematical functions. The two basic classes of trajectories of bounded growth are those of S-shaped, sigmoid growth, and of confined exponential growth. Scores of papers describe original derivations and subsequent modifications of these curves. There are also their extensive reviews, and perhaps the best overview is Table S1 in Myhrvold that systematically compares equations and constraints for more than 70 nonlinear growth functions. S-shaped growth. S-shaped functions describe many natural growth processes, as well as the adoption and diffusion of innovations, be they new industrial techniques or new consumer items. Initially slow growth accelerates at the J-bend, and it is followed by a rapid ascent whose rate of increase eventually slows down, forming the second bend that is followed by a slowing ascent as the growth becomes minimal and the total approaches the highest achievable limit of a specific parameter or a complete saturation of use or ownership. By far the best known and the most often used function of the S-shaped trajectory is the one expressing logistic growth. Unlike with exponential, unbounded growth, whose rate of increase is proportional to the growing quantity, relative increments of logistic limited growth decrease as the growing quantity approaches its maximum possible level that in ecological studies is commonly called carrying capacity. Such growth seems to be intuitively normal. A typical population grows slowly from an asymptotic maximum. It multiplies quickly. It draws slowly to an ill-defined and asymptotic maximum. The two ends of the population curve define, in a general way, the whole curve between, for so beginning and so ending, the curve must pass through a point of inflection. It must be an S-shaped curve. The origins of the formally defined logistic function go back to 1835 when Adolf Kettle, Belgian astronomer and at that time Europe's leading statistician, published his pioneering analysis Sur l'homme et le développement de ses facultés, ou essai de physique sociale, in which he pointed out the impossibility of prolonged exponential growth of any population. Kettle suggested that the forces opposing the indefinite development of the population increase proportionally to the square of the rate at which the population increases, and asked his pupil, mathematician Pierre-François Verhulst, 1804-1849, figure 1.9, to come up with a formal solution and then to apply it to the best available population statistics. Verhulst obliged and formulated the first equation expressing bounded population growth in his short notice in Correspondance mathématique et physique, The logistic model is described by the differential equation dn over dt equals rn multiplied by the sum of k minus n divided by k, with r being the rate of maximum growth and k the maximum attainable value, commonly known in ecology and population studies as carrying capacity. To test the growth equation's utility, Verhulst compared expected outcomes with relatively short periods of census data available for France, 1817 to 1831, Belgium, 1815 to 1833, Essex County, 1811 to 1831, and Russia, 1796 to 1827. And although he found a very accurate fit for the French series, he rightly concluded, given the brevity of the data series, that the future alone will be able to reveal to us the true method of operation of the retarding force. 7 years later, in a more expansive paper, he decided to give le nom logistique à la courbe. He never explained why he chose the name, but during his life the term was used in France to signify the art of computation, or he could have used it in the military sense of the word, provisioning the population, to suggest an arithmetical strategy. In his second paper, Verhulst illustrated the logistic curve by comparing it with exponential, logarithmic, growth, figure 1.10. The first part of the logistic curve, with population normale and when only good land is cultivated, is exponential, then a slowdown of growth sets in. The relative growth rate declines as the population increases. The inflection point, at which the growth rate reaches its maximum, is always half of the ultimate limit, and eventually, the population surabondante reaches its maximum. The instantaneous growth rate of the logistic function, its derivative with respect to time, is normally distributed, peaking at the curve's inflection point, figure 1.11. Higher rates of growth will produce steeper growth curves that reach the maximum level faster. The curve will be compressed horizontally, while slower growth rates will produce curves extended horizontally. In his 1845 paper, Verhulst assumed that the checks to further population growth would be proportional to the size of the excess population, population surabondante, and when he used this growth function to derive the ultimate limits of Belgian and French populations, he set them, respectively, at about 6.6 and 40 million to be reached before the end of the 20th century. But in his last paper on population growth, he concluded that the barriers to population growth are proportional to the ratio between the excess population and the total population. That change resulted in a larger ultimate population, or, as the asymptotic value became eventually known, in higher carrying capacities. Essentially, Verhulst's equation captures the shifting dominance between two feedback loops. A positive feedback loop, FBL, initiates growth that is eventually slowed down and brought into balance by a negative feedback that reflects the limits to growth prevailing in the finite world. As Kunsch put it, logistic growth is described as combining exponential growth embodied in plus FBL and goal-seeking growth embodied in a minus FBL. In that sense, Verhulst's function, with two feedback loops competing for dominance, can be seen as the very foundation of feedback-based systems dynamics developed by J. Forrester at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology during the 1950s and 1960s, and applied by the study supported by the Club of Rome on the global limits to growth. This key systemic concept of constrained growth, a high density of organisms being the proximate constraining factor and resource availability being the complex causative driver, has been very useful when conceptualizing many natural, social, and economic developments involving series of feedbacks, but its mechanistic application can result in substantial errors. Verhulst's original population forecasts are the earliest illustrations of such errors, because population maxima are not preordained by any specific growth function, but depend on changing a nation's, and ultimately the planet's, productive potential through scientific, technical, and economic development. How long such higher evolving maxima can be sustained is another matter. Verhulst eventually raised his Belgian population maximum by the year 2000 from 6.6 to 9.5 million, but by the end of the 20th century, the Belgian and French populations were, respectively, at 10.25 and 60.91 million. For Belgium, that was about 8% higher than Verhulst's adjusted maximum, but for France, the error was 52%. Although the second half of the 19th century saw an explosion of demographic and economic studies, Verhulst's work was ignored, and it was rediscovered only during the 1920s and became influential only during the 1960s. This was not the only instance of such forgetting. Gregor Mendel's fundamental experiments in plant genetics done during the 1860s were also ignored for nearly half a century. Could the neglect of Verhulst's work be ascribed to Kettler's reservations about his pupil's contributions, published in the older man's eulogy after the younger man's premature death in 1849? Udny Yule had a better explanation. Probably owing to the fact that Verhulst was greatly in advance of his time, and that the then existing data were quite inadequate to form any effective test to his views, his memories fell into oblivion. But they are classics on their subject. The next appearance of logistic function, without using that name, was to quantify the progress of autocatalytic reactions in chemistry. While catalysis denotes the increasing rate of a chemical reaction caused by the presence of an additional element, notably one of heavy metals, or a compound, often in minute quantities, autocatalysis describes a reaction that is catalyzed by its own products. Autocatalytic processes, reactions showing rate acceleration as a function of time followed by eventual saturation, are essential for the growth and maintenance of living systems, and without them, abiotic chemistry could not have given rise to replication, metabolism, and evolution. After Wilhelm Ostwald, 1853 to 1932, a leading chemist of the pre-World War I era, introduced the concept in 1890, it was quickly realized that the progress of the process follows a logistic function. The concentration of one reagent rises from its initial level, first slowly, then more rapidly, but then, limited by the supply of the other reagent, it slows down, while the concentration of the second reagent declines to zero. In 1908, T. Brailsford Robertson, 1884 to 1930, an Australian physiologist at the University.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.